Welcome, weary travelers, to the very first episode we're having here today on our channel. We're trying something new. We're going to call it Book Club of the Dead here on the Fight or Flight Network. Being the genuine horror fans that we are, we love reading, watching anything involved with horror, going to the, what's that bloody disgusting festival? Anything to do with horror. So we decided to do another... Monster Palooza. Yeah, Bloody Disgusting is the website.
Not affiliated.
At all.
It seems like it would be.
But.
Anyways, we like horror. So we decided to start doing another video series where we take apart, discuss, dissect, do whatever, certain classic books. This week we decided to start off with probably the most... important, I guess I would say. I don't know about important. Most well-known in the horror.
I would say more iconic.
Iconic, there you go. Bram Stoker's Dracula. It's a 1987 gothic horror novel by Irish author Bram Stoker, famous for introducing the character of the vampire Count Dracula. The novel tells the story of Dracula's attempt to move from Transylvania to England in order to find new blood and spread the undead curse. And the battle of Dracula and a small group of men and women who tried to defeat him. You guys have initial thoughts? Ratings?
Yeah, I think you said their date wrong.
Did I say 1987?
Yes.
1897. I'm dyslexic, you guys.
That's fine. I just wanted to make sure we got that.
Yeah. We read the 1987s.
John Carpenter.
Brown Stackers Get Cool.
Yes, specifically that.
Do you guys have initial comments? I know some of you guys have already read the book before, but some of you, like, I hadn't read it before. So what was your first initial thought, or what were your thoughts coming back and reading it again?
It was my first time reading it a couple months ago, and... I mean, unexpectedly, the way it was formatted, I wasn't expecting that, mm-hmm. In that it was letters written back and forth to each other, which I didn't really think that was the case based on all the fictionalized TV and film adaptations that I'm used to. But I did like that angle. I do like everything that's, even though everything that goes on is, you know, kind of, you know, very expected, and that's only because that's the source of what we come to expect in modern Dracula and vampire mm-hmm. Takes. I enjoyed it.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Did anything else surprise you?
No, I don't think anything else surprised me other than the lack of the lack of Dracula being a more romantic figure. That did surprise me because I usually see him depicted as a very sexual and romantic icon.
Thanks, Christopher
and
Lee.
In this case, yeah, thanks, Christopher Lee. But it's not the case in the book. He is
all business, no pleasure.
All business, idiosyncratic old man or monster, which is, that's fairly interesting. But everything else was great. I mean, as expected.
I remember from my first reading, because I had seen so many other things that had to do with Dracula at this point, I decided I was going to go back to the source, right? So my first time reading it, which was years ago, I remember a distinct lack of Dracula throughout the entire book.
That was a real shocker when I first read it. I was shocked.
Like, he's in the first bit of it, with Harker's journal.
Yeah.
But after that, he's there like four times, including...
Yeah, it's like a random sighting on the street and then dreams pretty much near the end.
Right.
There's a confrontation at one point, but it's so fast before the end.
Yeah.
So. You guys, I'm going to chew on this cinnamon stick so I don't smoke, so please don't be put off.
Just looks like you got a cigar now instead
exactly.
of...
exactly. I'm sorry. It's so gross, but I'll try to keep the noise to a minimum.
Brady, to our audio listeners.
Brady is speechless. It's a great visual.
All right, I want comments to make.
Anyway. So other
it's because of the dogs. You're not. It turns out that
mostly I enjoyed the book. Like it's to me, it's.
You said it was boring.
Boring. I didn't. Doesn't mean I didn't enjoy it.
Mm-hmm. All right.
I can watch history documentaries that are super boring, but still enjoy them.
I think reading Lord of the Rings is very boring, but I enjoy it.
Yeah, it's an enjoyable story.
I'm Paris.
I don't think boring is, for me, boring isn't a negative connotation. But okay. Bram Stoker in general is very boring, though I will say I do enjoy the fact that every character has their own voice. Mm-hmm. He did a pretty decent job with keeping the different styles for each character separate.
Yeah, I like that too. They help me keep my place.
Yeah. Especially, like, even when you're reading, like, Mina talk about what Van Helsing said. Like, she picks up on different things than what...
John Seward?
Yeah, what Seward would pick up. So,
oh, that's interesting. I didn't realize. They write the accents differently.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Hmm.
Yeah. So I don't know. It's pretty interesting. I enjoy it. But it's so boring. Okay. Nothing happens in the fucking book.
All right. No.
And that's okay. And that's not a bad thing.
Oh, right. No.
Not at all.
Yeah. I was really shocked when I heard it read first and on a recording, and it was just nothing like anything I had. It didn't match up with any of the movies or any of the series or anything I had seen. It was just like a completely different animal. And then I read it a couple of times since then. And I was thinking from what I talked about last time we talked, when we talked about the John Carpenter trilogy, which I don't know when it'll be out, but I talked about, you know, people working together. And I realized that that's one of the reasons I like this novel so much, is it's about people working together well, even though it's kind of everybody's super nice. They all tell each other how wonderful they are over and over and over again. But it's just nice to read, you know, they have this challenge that they have to deal with. And it's fascinating how they figure it out and hash it out. And there's a mystery thing too, where they're gathering information. There's a lot of kind of Sherlock stuff going on. It's not just horror. Mm-hmm. Of them, we had, you know, and there's a lot of philosophy, and there's a lot of, the book goes off in 100 different tangents. And, you know, I think everything that Stoker thought he could fit into it, he got in there, because there's, you know, if you whittled it down to the story, it would be much shorter, much smaller book. It's almost like a panorama of London, England at that time. All the different, he's got characters in different, with different accents, not just Van Helsing. They travel all over different parts of England, and also, you know, Transylvania and other parts in the East. So, I mean, it's got an it's small and yet, you know, expansive at the same time. And I was surprised at how subversive I found it, even though I know Bram Stoker is not Mr. Progressive. And of course, there's a lot of questions as to, there's so much ambivalence in the book. It's so, you can find evidence for any argument as to what Stoker's saying about pretty much anything. You know, it can be really right-wing and really anti-immigration, and yet it can also be interested in other cultures and a variety, you know what I mean? Like, politically, you could read it. And of course, the thing with women. And so there's just, it's like everything but the kitchen sink, basically. And I didn't realize it had that quality. And like Crystal, I think that the epistolary form, or the collage form, is so brilliant. It just wouldn't be what it is if it didn't have that sense of many people. You're getting many people's perspectives, and that makes it much more than just a horror story. It turns it into something very different, something kaleidoscopic. So
I think it's kind of funny that you said that everything he could get into it, he got into it. He actually wrote at least one other short story based off the bits that his editor told him he couldn't put in the book.
Yeah, was Dracula's guest, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
What was in there?
A weird interaction with Jonathan Harker, we think, anyway, in a like riding by a cemetery and seeing some weird thing happen, some lightning. Nothing happens here either at all. So,
well, I wonder why his editor said you can't put this in there.
Because it had nothing to do with anything.
But isn't there a dinner in it too?
I think
Oh, I don't remember. It's
like,
been so long.
It does involve, like, the only character that's actually named in it is Dracula.
Okay.
So we don't know if the narrator is Harker or not. It's never specified. So as far as we know, it is, you know, Dracula's guest.
Just like, guest.
A different guest.
I have this book that I'll talk about later, where the guy, the author, it's a nonfiction book, and he went to all, it's in Philly, all of his notes, you know, in the Rosenbach Museum and Library, and it's super quick, handwritten notes on the plot, single page document labeled Rosenbach 30C, and it says, the dinner party at the Mad Doctor's, 13, each has a number, each asked to tell something strange. Order of numbers makes the story complete. At the end, the count comes in. The divisional surgeon being sick, these are just him writing notes. None of this got into it. It's like, what else didn't get into the book? All these wild ideas that he had.
A lot of things. He really could have made this a series of books if he wanted to. I don't know why he didn't, to be honest, especially considering at the time this book didn't make him any money. No one cared about it. When people read it around the time, it really meant absolutely nothing to them. But the further, you know, longer time went on, people were going back and reading and like, oh, this actually relates now for some reason. I don't know.
Yeah, it's hard. Yeah, it's hard because, like you said, Crystal, and as we've said before, all the cinematic representations are romantic. So it's like the book continues to live. But does it continue to live because of the way that films have changed it? Or does it still live as a book? Like, do people actually even read the book?
That's something that I'd like to discuss later on as well. But for now, Monica, what was your impression of Septic Dracula?
So I never read this book because I was one of those many people that saw the Coppola film and thought, oh, okay, I don't need to read this book. I've seen the movie. And it wasn't until we had that discussion with Noel that I realized that the two are not one and the same. So I had no idea what to expect going into this because what I knew, I already knew, was going to be not true, basically. I absolutely loved it. I love found footage films, and I feel like this is almost like a found footage book. My favorite parts in the book were actually just the random newspaper clippings. Talking about missing children and stuff like that, because I'm like, oh, it's all coming together. yeah, I thought it was fantastic. I loved I'm not really a fan of, like, reading people's journal entries, because generally it's not what really happened, but I also kind of enjoyed it. And I feel like this is why everybody is so nice to each other, is because it's not actually what happened. It's what they're writing down later, like, oh yeah, of course we're best bros. But I found that kind of interesting because people lie in their journals. They lie to themselves. So it's really interesting to kind of read that and then wonder what actually played out. Because of course everybody's going to make themselves look awesome. But yeah, I thought it was, I was completely taken back with it. I understand why it's a classic.
That's an interesting thought about how people lie to themselves in their journals and such, and especially after they start collecting everything, there is almost a tone change. Everyone's like just gung-ho about working together. But Van Helsing doesn't keep a journal.
That's a good point.
He's in everybody else's eye.
That's a really good point.
He does discuss a few things. Like, he does come in and out a couple times, but not as much as everyone else. So what we see from him is from other people's perspectives. So we, especially like later on, when he decides to not tell Arthur that everyone else's blood has been in his wallet.
Oh, that's right. That's right. He never knows. Says,
by the way.
Oh, he does tell him.
He does tell him. But at like when we first discuss it, it's basically, no, we're not going to, it'll just be between us. Fine, whatever, we'll leave it. And then later on, he's like, no, we need to tell him. So we see this almost duality to Van Helsing, because everyone else gets to describe him rather than him tell his own story.
I don't remember him. Sorry, I don't remember him telling Jonathan. How does he respond?
Jonathan, tell Jonathan.
Not Jonathan, Arthur.
Oh, I mean Arthur. Oh, Lucy. Yeah. Right.
Arthur is surprisingly okay with it.
Yeah. He doesn't really have a choice at that
point. Yeah, I think he didn't want to tell him because it's kind of one of those things where it's like your wife has somehow been tainted. But, I mean, Arthur immediately knew it was to save her life. He's like, okay.
Right. Because the reason why they don't tell him is because he says it feels like they were actually married because of it. And that's reflected in something that Lucy said earlier, but whatever. It's just kind of...
We're doing it again. Do we have to give a plot synopsis?
I kind of did in the description.
Oh, that's true.
And I mean, it's Dracula.
Do we need to say who's who?
This is an interesting situation because this is the first time we've been discussing a book, and it's not like we can't say, hey guys, if you haven't read this book, pause, go read the book, and come back, because it might be like 4 months later. So, I mean, as of right now...
Well, that's kind of why we're doing classic pieces. I feel like most people are generally familiarized with them. Right. In this case, they should know, most people will know who Mina, Jonathan, Helsing are. It's the Arthur, Seward, Quincy, the other ones they might not know as well.
No one knows who Quincy is, and it's sad because Quincy's
never
one of my favorites.
I'm so in love with Quincy.
Isn't that the only representation of Quincy is in, like, for 5 seconds in the Coppola film, but I really think the character played by what's his name on Penny Dreadful really is taken off from Quincy in a way.
His
name.
He's the guy.
But he's much darker in Penny Dreadful, and Ethan, Quincy's not a werewolf.
Ethan, it's not something.
I don't remember his character's name. It's just Josh Arnett.
Who is another one of my man crushes for the record.
Oh, yeah,
Is he your horror hottie of the week?
Wait, Josh Arnett or Quincy the character?
Both.
Billy, what's his face, who played him in the Coppola movie. I love him so much. He's the Rocketeer, so. He's
Billy awesome. Crudup?
No, Billy.
Who's the Rocketeer? He's in 4400 too.
Oh yes, he is.
Me and Crystal have a Billy Campbell.
Really?
Me and Crystal have a big Billy crush on that Campbell. Guy.
Yeah.
Super huge crush on his character in 4400, and then when I found out he was also the Rocketeer, I just lost my mind.
So, sidetrack in Penny Dreadful. His character's name is Ethan Chandler, possibly real name Ethan Lawrence Talbot. Mm-hmm. And that Talbot is related to Lawrence Stewart Talbot, also
who
known
is
as the Wolf
Buffalo Bill. Also known as what?
The Talbot,
The Wolfman.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
they're being very cute.
Yeah, the show's full of that kind of stuff. Anyway, so, Monica, I know that you wanted, you had a thing that you wanted to talk about.
Yes, so this is where this discussion kind of gets different from our usual movie dissections. We all decided to bring forward a topic of interest to all of us, something that we focused on in the book. And then we're going to talk about it, dissect it. Everybody's going to get together. Actually, I wasn't going to go first, though. Who did we decide? Brady, weren't you going to go first?
Oh, because you're doing the history of the vampire tale.
Yeah, because I wanted to kind of do a little bit of both, but I was, Kenda and I were going to split that detail, so whatever. I guess I can kind of discuss a little bit of it. Specifically when it comes to Bram Stoker, everyone is pretty sure he took inspiration from Vlad the Third,
Vlad the Impaler.
Vlad the Impaler specifically.
Vlad the Poker?
Yes, exactly.
That's from what we do in the shadows, sorry.
Right.
You can poker on Facebook?
I was a little bit tyrannical.
I haven't seen that, so I guess I'm missing out on the joke.
Oh my god, you need to watch that.
No, I haven't seen it, so I will watch it eventually, but
you're gonna love whatever.
So Vlad, the I guess he's the prince of whatever.
Wallachia. Yes. Something like that.
Something. I don't know. Interesting person, to say the least. The reason why I wanted to bring him up specifically is because of what the Coppola film discusses, and we even get into like Dracula Untold and some other backstories. There's a lot of different characters spawned from Dracula specifically. At one point in time when I was talking to someone about, I was reading the book getting ready to do this, they're like, well, Dracula was a hero, and I went, no, never. I mean,
Vlad is a hero among his people.
No, he's not.
Yeah. He kept them from slavery for a few years.
Yeah, by murdering lots of people.
And he had a small country and no army, and he knew the only way to keep his people from slavery was through terror.
And he ran away twice, letting all of his people die.
He was a hero.
He lost control and went back and regained control. Mm-hmm. But mostly from what I've read, he wasn't necessarily a hero per se. Like, he kept them out of like Turkey's rule or whatever, but so did most all the other princes. So no big deal. Everyone was absolutely afraid of him because he was a madman and literally had forests of dead bodies on pikes.
He used to eat dinner in front of them too as a fear tactic.
Yeah, I mean, lots of really cool stuff.
Mm-hmm. Cool
One
stuff.
One of my personal favorites.
Brady, did you what do you think about the idea that the origin of vampire itself has something to do with the Lilith
mess? Usually.
So I think the best origin in general has been the Lilith aspect, specifically from the werewolf series, from the White Wolf, whatever the RPGs.
I like the Cain and Abel origin.
Oh, is that? I didn't know that was one of the.
Yeah, it's the World of Darkness.
Right.
The Eistrad. No, that's Ravenloft. That's Ravenloft. That's Ravenloft. Not World of Darkness.
Yeah,
that's
so
Ravenloft,
World of Darkness is the one that I'm talking about, where Lilith was, when she was exiled from Eden, she ended up being consoled by various creatures, one being a bat, one being a wolf, another one being a snake, and some other things, whatever.
That's similar to the underworld.
So she gave birth to a vampire, a werewolf, and then the snake child was stillborn.
Hmm.
I don't know. So really, really interesting idea there. But based off of the idea that, you know, Dracula was based off of Vlad, very much there's, you can see a lot of those aspects in Bram Stoker's Dracula.
Mm-hmm.
He recounts some of the battles, like how Dracula like ran away and then came back to fight again, something Vlad did, and some other bits and pieces here and there.
Well, he has that monologue basically about why they're great people,
mm-hmm.
and he does talk as if he's speaking from the voice of the leader of the people.
He's not speaking as if his grandfather did this. He's speaking as if he was there.
Right.
And I find it very moving because it really seems like it's the only time Dracula's like passionate and honest. He's like being honest.
Right, which is a lot of fun. So, also, I just wanted to double check something. Vlad's reputation was considerably darker in Western Europe than in Eastern Europe and Romania.
Mm.
In the West, he was characterized as a tyrant who took sadistic pleasure in torturing and killing his enemies. So that's exciting. Well,
who didn't? I mean, come on.
Right.
Look at the time frame.
Yeah. So that's exciting. There's another vampire series that I think everyone needs to go watch. It's called Subspecies. Really entertaining because the main vampire in that is named Radu, and Vlad the Third had a half brother, I guess, named Radu as well. Yeah, neat stuff.
It's a series of movies, Subspecies.
In 1991. Oh, right. I see.
The first one is really, I really enjoy the first one, and then they just,
it's got the Phantasm guy.
Yes.
Oh.
Playing Dracula.
Oh, perfect.
Yeah.
I just downloaded it. Sorry. Back up. I just obtained Phantasm. I'm finally going to watch it.
Yeah.
Sorry.
So, historically speaking,
hard to find.
Dracula, the book, does have some real world inspirations, and that tends to not be as reflected in some of the newer stories that we get into. Dracula 2000, we have him as Judas.
That was a fun story, too.
It was a fun spin.
It had vitamin C in it.
What?
Mm-hmm.
Vitamin C.
It also had a 7 and 9 in it.
Yes, I think. I don't remember.
Mm-hmm. Sherry Redding. Yeah, she was one of Dracula's brides.
Right.
The prettiest one.
Right. So that is probably the most interesting thing I found about, you know, Bram Stoker's, like, the history of Dracula is he obviously did take some real world inspiration, and from a book where a character is, like I had said earlier, he's really not in the book that often. He's only in a little bit. We have this huge mythos of vampires, which wasn't invented by this, but we all kind of know vampires to stem from Dracula.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of
or Carmilla.
Yeah, I mean, there are previous, you know, the previous novels. Oh, yeah,
absolutely.
1812.
In general, when we talk to the normal public people, we start talking about vampires, their first thought goes straight to Dracula. We have the same thing in like other pop.
No, it goes to Robert Pattinson.
That's where we all go.
Firstly. But what's interesting, everybody should read Carmilla because it's really short and it's Sheridan Le Fanu. It's from like the early 19th century. It's like 90 years, 80 years before Dracula.
Vampires.
It's pretty much full on lesbian. It's implied.
Which one is this?
Carmilla.
Oh.
It's really nice, but it's interesting that it is very dreamlike. It's definitely got the gothic the gothic and the romantic thing that I don't think Dracula has, even though it's always said to have that.
But yeah, that was a big surprise to me, is how not romanticized this Dracula is, and he's always been.
But Carmilla is really fascinating, and it is short. And then there's another one, the vampire, the Polidori. Oh, I'm sorry, Brady. Were you going to cover this stuff?
No.
The there's the famous night where Polidori, Mary Shelley. Polidori was the personal physician of Shelley, of Mary Shelley's husband, the poet Shelley. And then who else was there? It was Shelley.
Byron.
Byron, yeah. That night that they said, well, I'll make horror stories. And that's what inspired Mary Shelley to write Frankenstein. But there's a short fragment or a short vampire story that Polidori wrote. And it had initially been attributed to Byron, but it turns out Byron wrote a different vampire thing. But the Polidori one's really cool too. In this case, it's two men. It's an uncle and a nephew. And it's also, again, these are like 70 years. It was like this big gap before, I don't know. I mean, was Stoker picking up on something that was already out of fashion, or was he trying to regenerate it, or had it not been exploited? Because there's not that many there's not that many versions of the vampire story before that, well, in English anyway.
When it comes to Stoker, a lot of people do kind of agree, and my opinion specifically is he wrote something ahead of his time, as it was, I guess. Because there wasn't a lot going on in the book that really relates to the time period that it was written.
You don't think so?
No. I mean, not a lot. Little things here and there, but not a lot. Like, the most specific thing would be just the fact that England had basically stopped taking over other countries at the time, and Bram Stoker, being Irish, obviously thought that was a bad idea. So, other than that, it's just kind of a conglomeration of possibilities. We don't really know, because this is, since it wasn't popular, no one cared to ask him or document anything that he really meant by any word that he wrote at all. I just wanted to cover the history of where Dracula came from, rather than really get into what was going on at the time. So I didn't really look into that.
I'll talk a little bit more about that stuff.
I'm pretty sure he wrote something ahead of his time. It didn't get popular until much later on, and I think it didn't even get popular until after his death. So it was just one of those things that just kind of happened. Obviously, there were lots of vampire stories beforehand.
I was kind of interested to see.
Oh, yes.
I was interested to know how much of the lore of Dracula was before the book, and how much he created, like the whole can't cross running water, the crosses, the night.
A lot of that was a lot of the superstition. Like, there wasn't a lot of books written about vampires, but there were a lot of stories, a lot of tales, lots of little superstitions.
The whole, like, he has to have dirt from his homeland at all times. Right. Like, I was interested to know if that was Dracula or if that was before Dracula.
We're starting to get into the shady sort of situation, because as much as we talk about this being like the origin of vampires, and it's not, it kind of is the conglomeration of a bunch of these stories that weren't really written down.
Yeah, I think it's more the actualization of vampires as a whole.
I should have grabbed the book while I was in Idaho, but I have this book, like, huge, thick book of vampire stories, and it...
Goes through the history of them?
No. Collections of vampire stories that led up to our current superstitions. So
no, but I mean, do they go back to Carmilla and the Polidori story and the early stuff, Varney the Vampire?
No, like before that.
Before that?
Yes. So we're talking
like urban legends,
like the the superstitions, folklore. What people would say before they knew about, you know, science and things. So, like, the origins of vampires.
Legends.
From all kinds of, I think there's...
All the different versions of it.
Like, there's...
There's versions from all over the world, right?
Yeah, uh-huh. It is one of the interesting things when it comes to, like, a lot of our horror stuff. Vampires, dragons, werewolves, zombies, all kinds of things. Like, there's versions of these throughout multiple regions of the world that way back in the day really had no way to discuss these sorts of things.
Because we all have the same basic fears.
Yes. All basic superstitions and things like that.
There's also, a lot of them are female, the early ones, like mothers eating, like witch stuff, right? Yes. Some of those are considered like early vampire stories.
So, I mean, there's a lot of vampire stories that aren't what we consider vampires nowadays because of, well, honestly, it comes down to Nosferatu and moving forward. Because
cinematic representations, you mean?
Right. Because that's what people have clung to. There are multiple books, even... like before we started getting into film, but what society thinks of now has really been formed because of the films. A lot of them being Dracula based. Nosferatu was Dracula based. How many actors have been Dracula? There was one other than Christopher Lee that I can't think of right now.
Bela Lugosi.
No, I can't remember that one. Assholes. But there's another one.
Bela Lugosi is the one, though, that he's the one that that romanticized.
That was the most popular ones, yes. And it's because
I just googled how actors who have been Dracula, and like there's a 600. Lot.
Yes. Yeah. Like there's so
many. Rucker Hauer?
Could have been that. Maybe. One.
I think you're thinking of Kiefer Sutherland.
Yes.
Obviously. I bet Rucker Hauer played a vampire at some point.
Yeah, he did a lot Dracula. Of Dutch
films before.
But anyway, they all have different iterations. Like Nosferatu wasn't Dracula, but it was totally Dracula. Very like monstrous, whatever. Lugosi became very regal, I guess is the word.
Yeah,
and then. There's a couple others that actually meant something. I can't remember their names right now. Christopher Lee is kind of known for the sexualization, which is really weird to think about.
Gary Oldman, too.
No, he's not sexy, Monica. I'm sorry.
They keep trying to Gary make him.
Wait, who?
Gary Oldman.
Like,
he's supposed to be sexy in that movie.
Ever and I'm tried like, to make him sexy ever.
He's not sexy in that movie. Well, they tried to make him sexy in Scarlet Letter, too. And
didn't work.
Well, I mean, you be the judge. You can see his butt.
He does become very romantic when he gets younger in London, I think. I think there's some chemistry point, with him.
But it's not as sexualized as others, especially when we compare it to the Dracula in the novel. Not once, ever. The closest thing we get to sexualization of vampires is the brides, and... the one time where she was going to kiss Jonathan, and that was about it.
There is the scene where he's forcing, much later in the novel, where he's forcing Mina to drink his blood, his chest. That's pretty graphic and
but
shocking.
It's not sexualized.
I don't know.
It more is like like he was becoming her new parents because she was like suckling from the breast like a baby would.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah.
He was her parent in the like the new life, like the nightlife.
And a lot of people have run with that side of the story, including the great nephew of Stoker.
Stoker.
Whereas I think he continues the story of Quincy Harker, because Quincy was actually
Not Quincy Harker.
No, Quincy.
Oh, Harker. The boy, the son. That's they named right.
Their kid.
They named Quincy. Their kid Quincy. Right. That's right.
So in in this continuation, Quincy was actually a product of rape.
Oh, wait a minute.
Oh yeah, rape like they just go straight into that for no fucking reason.
Wait a minute, are they implying that yes. Jonathan raped Mina?
No. That Dracula raped Mina.
Oh, let's not talk about this.
Yeah, it's violent. Dude is a really good writer. Like I really dig some of the other stuff that I've read of his. But no, just.
And this is actually Bram Stoker's great nephew.
Yes.
Yeah.
Especially considering a lot of other people have run off with this, talking about how Mina was the last one, possibly the only one, that Dracula turned and actually allowed to feed off of him.
Well, it's so probably true, right? She may be the
only one that ever drank.
Yeah, Lucy didn't feed off of him.
So what is what's the significance of the feeding from him rather than him feeding on her?
I think that was more spiteful towards Jonathan. I mean, yeah. The whole reason he was going after Mina was spite.
Right, because he's an asshole. I mean, he was feeding on her too, but actually like gave of his blood to her, which would possibly enhance or quicken the turning into a vampire or giving more powers, because we don't see Lucy doesn't seem to have terrible transformation powers. Of course, she's young, doesn't really do a lot, whatever. And
well, when she's the white lady, she's attacking the kids. It's
right,
pretty,
but she's scary. Drawing them in, but not really.
She's transforming. She's not her former self. She's just a thrall. Maybe he was somehow drinking Dracula's blood would keep Mina. But that's all speculation. I've heard that theory a few times, but I don't actually know.
The bride.
But I think you're right though, that the image is to shock them. It is spiteful.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And it has a sexual component to it. It's certainly the most physically intimate we see Dracula get with anybody.
I will give you that. Sexual, no. Sexualization.
You're the one that's into. Oh, sorry. Nothing. You mentioned you when we talked about May. Actually, you said that we talked about blood people with alternative sexual practices of like blood play and that kind of stuff.
Right.
So that's all I was referring to.
Sexualization of anything is all perspective. Like some people sexualize things that others don't. Just hands down, that's the way it is.
It's hard to know what Stoker intended by that image. It's and a shocking image, even today.
That's specifically why I wanted to say that it wasn't popular enough for anyone to actually ask him and document what he meant by any of the words he wrote.
There were no interviews with the hot new author.
Exactly. So everything that we discussed during this is
speculation.
Yeah. Like, we can see a lot of similarities between Vlad and Dracula, but we don't know if he just made that shit up and it just happens to relate.
Well, there are those boxes of his notes in Philadelphia, apparently.
Yeah. I think a lot of it, too, is just people piecing things together for their own stories and connecting it to the original. But, I mean, that's good. That's how things organically grow. That's a Lovecraft thing too. That's how his stories have gotten so big, is people have just taken and worked and ran with it.
And maybe if there's still time, because I need to stop talking, I'll discuss some of the new Draculas that exist based off of this character that have just been fleshed out by so many other people. Yes, lots of them.
Yeah.
Well, you've mentioned a few.
I've mentioned a few, but I haven't even gotten into like comics, video games, other other movies that.
Alucard, Morbius. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, then the question, and then there's of course the question of why has it become this thing again? Exactly. But that's another question.
That's kind of the question that I'll leave the entire thing with, is why did people latch onto this character who, to me, is not fleshed out very well
in the book.
He's like a half a character.
Yeah. He's more of a, he's like the impetus for the novel. He's not the actual focus of the novel.
Exactly. But why have people latched onto that and created this huge mythos for Dracula in general?
It's the promise of power.
Is it though?
And there's also there's a romanticized form, there's the power, but it's also a lot of these stories is similar to why zombies are so big, is that at any given moment you could be trying to kill someone you loved because now they are one of the enemy.
That you can't, you don't know people. Sorry, Christian.
Oh, I was just gonna say that and, you know, people wanting to live forever.
Mm-hmm. Immortality. That's the power, yeah. Thing.
But why did we latch on to Dracula? Why not, you know, Carmilla or anything else?
Yeah, or Varney the Vampire. What's interesting, I wonder, now that you're talking, now that we're talking this way, I wonder if Stoker would be horrified, because clearly Stoker means him to be nothing but, like, pure horror. The thought of him is horrifying. The idea of him coming.
If I was going to compare...
And now now he's a hero, like, you know.
Oh, yeah. If I was going to compare Dracula, like the character, to any other villain, it would probably have to be the original Maleficent, because they are created purely to be the villain and to be pure, just evil in general.
People have run with them.
Right.
Taken to light. That's always shocked me, how Patrick Bateman's become like a hero, like become this character, even though he was written to be a non-character and just pure, vicious evil. And now he's like, they wrote an opera and they're like people, you know what I mean? He's like, or it's the same thing with, I can't imagine that Carpenter thought that Michael Myers was going to be the whole point is that he's nothing. He's just an empty cipher. Mm-hmm. And yet he becomes this character that people really, I don't know, are excited by or connected to. And
right.
It's like,
I mean,
it's just,
the reason why I fell in love with Michael Myers was the fact that he was just snapped. Not even snapped, just became whatever. Like, he just moved forward. And that's why I hate, like, Rob Zombie's stuff, because they made him a tortured individual. No, he's just... Like, why do we have to have this?
He was crazy as a child, and I don't think he was...
Yeah, there wasn't really a snap.
Abused or anything. He was just a crazy-ass kid.
Right, but in the original story, he's just a normal kid. Everyone loves him, and then all of a sudden, he's killing everybody. In Zombies, like, he's shooting animals and being a bastard and just whatever. He's showing the traits.
Yeah, I mean, he seems like a very innocent child at the beginning of Halloween, and then it's just like, what are you doing?
Right.
Ship him away.
Zombie well, definitely took a lot of the...
Well, maybe that's the modern part. Maybe Stoker didn't realize he was writing a hero, quote unquote, or anti-hero for the 20th century.
Right.
With Dracula, I think he thought he probably would think what we've done with it is pervert it, but he didn't. That's one of the ways maybe he was ahead of his time. That the 20th century is a very violent century and is very different from the 19th, and absolutely. Dracula becomes like.
I think
he starts to represent all kinds of other things that Stoker would never have dreamed of.
Right.
A lot of things that we used to have a problem with back then, we don't have a problem with. So the fact that he was like, more sexualized, and we're not as big into what is godly and ungodly anymore. So certain things that used to be just completely appalling to them back then, we're just like, meh, whatever.
Well, unfortunately, the anti-immigration thing has never gone away.
Yeah.
Because there's no question that Stoker's saying these people from the East are going to come and they're going to take over. I asked, well, I'll continue that thought in a minute, but so you have to go, Monica.
Yeah, I'm going to stop talking.
You have a big chip on your shoulder that you need to get.
Do it, girl.
Well, okay, so the topic that I was going to talk about was feminism in the book, or lack thereof. But I do feel like I should say a few things before I start this. I understand these are just Bram Stoker's opinions written. It's not necessarily an accurate depiction of the time. This is just one man. That's not my problem. My problem is that people still see his depiction as a feminist modern woman, and I'm like, no. Also, I do love Mina Harker, so that some of these things might come off as kind of harsh as Mina. I do love her. I do feel she is very strong. She is intelligent. She's a great female lead. She really is, but I don't think she's being given credit in the way that she deserves it, and I think she's given credit that she doesn't deserve. But I do love her, and I definitely want to stress that. It's not that I hate Mina Harker in this book. I still love her. But yeah, that being said, growing up, all I've heard stories about Mina Harker, and when I see her depicted, she's always like this bad A, tough as nails, smarter than everyone, super articulate, outspoken, just great character. Like, she's definitely a role model for children. And when I read the book, I was completely floored at the fact that I felt like none of that was there. It, maybe in small doses and in small pieces, but where it is there, I almost feel like it's an insult to the modern woman, or not quite. It's a twisted depiction. I mean, obviously, this is coming from a man of the time, like I said, but I still feel like it shouldn't hold up to today's standards. Like, whatever, it's a period piece back then, but why are we still seeing it that way today?
Do you think that maybe you feel that way because she was built up so much in your mind growing up?
Yeah, most definitely. And she was built up as this super strong character. And then, like, even when every single person I brought this topic to, because since I read the book, I would just be like, oh man, I couldn't believe, like, you know, she said this in the book, or this happened in the book. And they're just like, well, yeah, but Mina's like, she's really awesome. She's really hardcore. She does all this stuff. And I'm like, no, she's actually not. At least not in the ways that people think she is. She is a very strong character.
Give us some examples.
Yeah, I was going to say, this is where I'm going to start. So this is the biggest argument, that she is a modern woman. And I'm just going to go, Lord Byron states that a modern woman is someone who is both socially and sexually liberated. That doesn't mean she's a slut, Brady. That just means that she's not afraid of...
We're not talking about Lucy right now.
Right.
She's not afraid of talking about sexual things or being more open with her sexuality, but that doesn't mean she sleeps with people. That just means she's, like, not afraid to talk about her knickers or something like that. It's, and then the socially liberated is more along the lines of being well-educated, being able to join in like, gentlemen's conversation and not being a burden on the conversation, and not just reciting rhetoric either. Being socially liberated means you're more about current affairs, you're smart, you know what's going on, and you're not afraid to speak your mind. And Mina Harker is very educated. She's probably more educated than Jonathan is himself. But the book makes a point of saying that she studied along with Jonathan Harker to help him. My biggest issue is, if she was so socially liberated and not afraid... The other thing about being socially liberated is not afraid of what other people think of you. Like... basically not being afraid of what is a woman's role and what is a man's role and going beyond that. And so if she is so socially liberated, then why wasn't her goal to take the solicitor test and become a solicitor with Jonathan, and instead of becoming his secretary, becoming like Harker and Harker solicitors or something like that? Instead, every single time she talks about why she did this, it is to be a better wife and to help Harker do whatever he wants to do, which is great. If that's what you want to do, sure. But that's not a socially liberated woman, and that's not a strong female role model. It's a good wife.
Well, I mean, you have to consider, what do you know about feminism suffraging in 1897. Maybe she
quite a
the
bit.
Test
there
because
were so
it was,
many.
It was well advanced by
yeah,
that point.
Yeah, it was
the,
really
the suffragette advanced. Movement
I know
had been
exists,
going for a long time.
She maybe she didn't take the test because she couldn't like it. Being completely unallowed to take
no,
the test.
She wouldn't have. If she had, if she had the option, even if she.
It wasn't one of those things where, because you're a woman, you cannot do this. She could go to school. She could take these tests. She might have had a harder time getting a job because of it or references. But if she's going to work with Jonathan, then she would just work with Jonathan.
She's extremely submissive. There's no question
yeah,
that everything she
submissive.
Does is in support of Jonathan or the other men, for sure.
Yeah, and to help your point, Monica, I think it's really interesting to talk about Mary Shelley's history. Mm-hmm. And, you know, she was decades and decades before this novel was written, and she was already at a point where she was completely a liberated modern woman. So yeah. Nina is a little bit of a step back from even Mary Shelley herself.
And you all
is an interesting concept because she was a feminist before feminism even existed.
Well, her mother was.
Wollstonecraft was the premium.
Right.
But I think a better parallel is what you said before, Monica, or what you wrote in here, the character from which character from which novel?
Elizabeth Bennet.
Yeah, I think comparing her to that is more is fairer, that what can be represented in fiction mm-hmm. at the time. And those that Austen's women are just way, way ahead. I mean, this is written by a very conservative guy who yeah. wants his women Stepford style for sure. Smart.
Yeah, and I understand that. That's
time.
His point of view. But my problem is that everybody keeps telling me, no, she's a strong modern woman.
I don't see Mina as
who are these people, Monica?
Just about everyone I talk to, Dracula.
Who and what are the badass versions that you saw as when you were younger?
League of Extraordinary Gentlemen.
League of Extraordinary Gentlemen.
She was so bad, eh?
Yeah.
And I've seen her depicted in comics and video games and stuff, and she's usually like right alongside Van Helsing or
definitely not in any of the movies though.
No, the movies she's still a little more muted. But
the movies
even
are worse than the book.
Even the Coppola version of Mina, I feel like is slightly more modern because she takes a few more liberties.
Well, at the end, yeah, she's pretty helpless up until then.
Yeah, but she does kiss Jonathan, too, and that makes her a little bit more willing to risk taboos sexually. So that kind of gives her a little bit more leeway. Anyways, the other things, she does have a job, which is still a little taboo for a woman, but she still takes a socially acceptable job for women. Again, she could have been a solicitor, but no, she's like a schoolmarm, because that's what women are supposed to be. She does have a lot of really witty lines, really intelligent, but they're only in her journal. She only truly expresses herself in the comfort of her own home and the privacy of her own journal. There's one line that I died laughing where a priest comes to visit them, and she and Lucy were tired from walking that day, and she was saying when like priests go to school, they should teach them how to know when women are sleepy, because they don't need to be preaching to sleepy women or something like that. And I thought it was hilarious. And that was in a very Jane Austen sense. Like, that felt like a line from Elizabeth Bennet, but she didn't say it to the preacher. She didn't say it to anyone. She just wrote it in her journal, which that's not being socially liberated. That's just being any pent-up, frustrated woman who just puts all her thoughts in her journal because she can't say anything out loud.
Well, to be honest, everyone does that, not just women.
Yeah, yeah. So. No. But I mean, we all.
But Elizabeth Bennet would have said that.
I think things that we say and don't say, but.
My favorite line is after they had been done eating, and they both laughed at how they ate enough that they would worry the mm-hmm. new modern woman.
And that's something I feel like was an insult to modern women more than it was. Yeah, because modern women was another depiction of a modern woman was someone who didn't care as much about keeping that insanely slim figure. They ate what they wanted, and they also exercised. Women weren't supposed to exercise.
Right.
But, but modern women would. They would play sports.
To me, they said that in the sense of, yes, the modern women are being more like out in eating and having fun doing whatever the thing. They ate twice as much as that because they felt like being fatties.
Yeah, I don't know. When I read that, I felt like it was patronizing, but yeah,
Stoker's being patronizing. You don't think so?
No.
You don't think so, Brady?
No, not at all.
Isn't there another place where the modern woman in quotation marks comes up?
Yeah, and I thought I wrote it down, but
Let me put it this way, Brady. I think that Stoker's making a point of saying, no matter how smart and together Mina is, don't ever mistake her for a suffragette. He's making a distinction there. Or whatever.
Suffragist is a more acceptable term. However, I think to me, in my perspective, when I was reading it, both three, four times, whatever, especially when they're talking about the man brain, which I know Monica loves that.
Oh, God, don't even.
to me, it's saying, look, she can do everything that the men can do. In fact, she's organizing all of this where the men had no idea, no gumption to actually do it. So yes, she is strong. She can do these things and we should let her. I think that the term of like the man brain was the more
pointed. It could have been the best society that Bram Stoker could do language-wise. In order to be on the side of women,
right?
In that time, you could say something that is totally patronizing today.
Yeah,
yeah. And I get that. Again, it's coming from Bram Stoker, but my worry is that, like, even in the case, like, Brady feels like, yes, this is still a modern. No.
I feel that he was on the side of feminists at the time.
No, he wasn't. He really wasn't.
Brady?
No,
he was an arch conservative. He was super right wing, by our standards. I mean, he was reactionary. He hated women. He's notorious. His other books. You've read the other ones?
No.
Oh, Lair of the White Worm and stuff.
I feel like this is Bram Stoker kind of saying something like your racist grandpa might say something like, "Oh, they sure can dance."
Yeah.
Yeah, there's like also a lot of things that bothered me, like
parallel. No, like legit, like that. That's what I'm saying. At the time, he was very much like for the women's movement, but
he wasn't.
Show me an article that says that he was against the women's movement.
We will do this after the conversation. I will find this for you. But right now, there's other things that really bothered me in the book. Like basically, anytime that she wasn't talking about what was currently going on, all she was talking about was being a good wife, being a good mother. She just kept reiterating this, like, this is the only thing women think about, which I understand. Bram Stoker's not a woman. He doesn't know what we think about. But he's got to imagine it's more than just, oh, I can't wait till I'm a wife.
And she says that a lot.
Yeah, she does.
Over and over again.
Another thing that struck me in the novel that kind of really agitated me, socially liberated characters wouldn't care what other people think about them amidst an emergency situation, such as Lucy wandering off in the middle of the night, sleepwalking in her pajamas across the city. It was incredibly quick thinking of Mina to take off her shoes and give them to Lucy and then pat her feet with mud to make people think they were both wearing shoes. But I'm sorry, if Crystal's sleepwalking in the middle of the night, walking out in the middle of nowhere, I'm not going to care what these guys crossing us across the street are going to think. I'm going to be trying to get Crystal back home so she doesn't die of a cold or something.
Why am I the Lucy?
Here.
Because Monica thinks you're a slut.
Well, I do
want to
sleep with Quincy. It's fine.
I mean, but so does Brady.
I mean, yeah, it's like your friend could. I mean, this is the day when going out without clothes in the middle of the night could equal death. And you're more worried about what the people passing you are thinking about two ladies out in the middle of the night than you are hurrying up and getting your friend back home.
And I'm in my slutty small clothes, so it's another issue. It's cold outside, yo.
And then sexual liberation is just not there for Mina at all. She is probably one of the most reserved women ever. And I honestly feel like Lucy, if you put Lucy and Mina together, they slightly... is not afraid of expressing her emotions. She's very open about every single thing she's feeling, what she's doing. She's much more liberated in that sense, but then, I mean, she also gets depicted as a ditz, which kind of, she's not really more of a modern woman, but if you put them together, they almost make a modern woman.
I also don't see the ditz in Lucy.
You're the one that's, oh, you see the sluts and not the ditz?
Well, Lucy... Lucy, there's a few times where Lucy tries to keep up with conversation and then she just changes the subject. And I took that as she didn't know what they were talking about.
Oh, that's interesting.
Well, I mean, she doesn't.
Yeah. I mean, so,
but it comes down to...
I guess
to...
it doesn't make her a ditz, but she's not well-versed in, like, current affairs or anything like that.
And it's, to be honest, I mean, that's a personal preference because she also discusses the fact that, you know, she wants to, like... When can women have, you know, marry as many people as they want?
Again,
in the future, women will be.
I mean, I get that, but
it's a shocking line, though, when it comes
out. She says it to her best friend and no one else. Like, she doesn't say it in a conversation in a crowded room. She says it to the one person she trusts not to tell anyone else.
I mean, other than the fact that these are characters written in one situation, there's no way to tell that. She hasn't said that to other people multiple times.
No, just by seeing her character, hang out with anybody else. She wouldn't say that.
No one hangs out with anyone else in these books. Like, we can try to discuss these characters as full on fleshed out human beings, but they're not. So when you say she's only said it to one person, you don't know.
But
that,
just but knowing her character from what we see, it's very obvious that she would not bring that up in a conversation with a room full of people. She wouldn't do that.
Everybody's discretion is an important part of this culture. Everybody's concerned about discretion. And in some ways I like that, but yeah, it goes a little too far sometimes. But I think that Mina wouldn't want to hang out with Lucy if Lucy was a total numbskull.
She's not.
They would have nothing. They would have no. There'd be no sympathy between them. There has to be more similarities than differences, I think.
Yeah, and I guess ditz was the wrong word. I don't really feel like she's a ditz, but I was trying to say that Lucy isn't a better depiction of a modern woman because she isn't up on current affairs or isn't as educated as Mina is. Yeah. And so that's what I was saying. Together, they almost make a modern woman, but they're still short. They're still both shy in a few factors. Another thing that people bring her up as a strong character is because she's a unifying force for everyone. Like, she's the one that brings everybody together. She's like the linchpin to Lucy. She's the linchpin to Jonathan, to Van Helsing. All these characters, she's kind of the center of the story, but really she's not. It's only because of her proximity. It's not because she has abnormal strength or determination. It's strictly proximity. She does show strength. She does show pretty good strength, but it's usually in a maternal role.
I think I'm going to go ahead and say that anyone that says that Mina is the linchpin for everyone has never actually read the book.
She kind of is.
Because Seward is. Seward's the one that connects everybody.
Seward doesn't connect Harker.
I think Mina unifies everybody in that she's the one that they can save.
I mean, to a point, yes. And she is the one that actually works to collect everything and put it in chronological order. Harker does help with that. I mean, Jonathan does help with that. But for the most part, when we look at all the characters, Seward
well, he brings been friends with Quincy.
Knows Helsing, hangs out with Arthur, is in love with Lucy.
Lucy
knows Mina.
And Mina only knows them through Lucy.
Is marrying Jonathan. Jonathan has no connection to anyone other than Mina. Mina is
related.
And Dracula.
Well,
Jonathan is the connection to Dracula, and Jonathan's the reason why Mina gets targeted.
First, sure.
No, but I hear what you're saying, Brady. But there's still, it's hard to get, even if technically she's not the actual hinge, I can't imagine the novel without her. It's just there would be no novel without her.
She's
the driving
force.
Whether it's a question, I think it's a question of narrative structure. And actually, I go even further. I may as well just reveal my hand now and say, Mina puts together, it's her idea. She says, we need to get all this information in one place. But she says, we have to turn this into a story so we can follow, figure out what his logic is and how to trap him. So she's also a researcher. Mm-hmm. She's also big on facts and figures and memorizing things. She's also got all the technology for writing stuff down, for recording people. She does a lot of transcribing.
Shorthand, yeah.
But she's putting everything together into a narrative. I think she's a stand-in. I don't know whether Stoker realizes it or not, but it's a self-portrait of Stoker without any doubt in my mind. Mina's interested in everybody. She's ravenously curious about everybody and everything. I mean,
I really love too, like at that moment you realize like what you're reading is actually what Mina collected and put together. Like this is Mina's book.
I don't think that Stoker realized that, but it's like, who else? I mean, you could say all the men are different facets of maybe one man or Stoker, or maybe he imagines himself as these manly, virile men.
Maybe Stoker imagines himself as Mina.
But I think she's a stand-in, if not a self-portrait. She's definitely there in place of Stoker. So that makes her crucial to the novel. What Stoker intended, I don't know what he feels about that or how we're supposed to feel about that. But without her, there's no story.
I think Stoker wanted to be a woman.
I guess it's obvious. It really is obvious now.
So
isn't
I'm going through and reading a bunch of articles as fast as I can for this conversation. And for the most part, what I'm finding is at the time, Stoker wrote Mina as both the depiction of the ideal woman and the new woman.
And that bothers me, that that's his idea of an ideal woman and the new woman.
That was like, everyone has been saying that then is what he's reflecting. And then
I don't think
a good thing.
There were so many women at that time that were so much more.
I haven't seen anything that says that she was a poor depiction or even a depiction of a submissive woman. So I really need you guys to show me these opinions, because as far as I know, for the time when he wrote it, this character.
Well, he wasn't. I don't think he was spending a lot of time with people involved in the women's movement. So I don't think he did any research.
One, Irish.
I wish I still had it. I don't have my original notes because I had 5 pages full of just modern women before this book.
Like, oh,
real
really?
Life modern women. And I was like, no, I don't need that for that argument. I'm like, I should have kept it.
You really do. Because
I don't. I'd have to look it up again.
You have to look specifically at the UK. For one,
well, and I know deeper. Florence Nightingale was before this book. I know Jane Austen was before this book. I know Mary Shelley was before this book. There was also, and I can't remember her name because it's this stupid, complicated name. But there was this woman who is basically what Lord Byron was basing what the modern woman should be off of, and she was a social commentator. In the newspaper, and she wrote articles about things that were going on, and she was, I think originally she was writing under the pen name as a man, and then she came out as a woman, and everybody still accepted her because it was the time. Everybody agreed, like, oh, you know, you're a woman. So, I mean, she got some.
That's not Wollstonecraft.
I know she did something similar.
Because Wollstonecraft actually ran the school where the Bronte sisters went to as well, and
like a progressive school for girls.
Does she have the lady I'm talking about was a writer in a newspaper.
Well she definitely produced novels
all the
about feminism.
Wrote regularly articles.
There were a lot of great depictions of women before this. And I don't feel like Lucy's a bad depiction. I just don't feel like she's the new woman, the modern woman that everybody keeps saying Mina? She
like,
is.
Absolutely. Like, Mina to us now, even in the past 20
years. I don't
years,
think back then she was. She wasn't back then.
That's really hard for me to really accept as any information, because as I'm reading through information from 1897, there was a lot of anomalies, but it's not like women were stepping up. In fact, what was it, like 1840, 1835, women had just had their right to vote revoked.
So Mina's not interested in striving for what she doesn't mm-hmm. have. She's not looking to increase her sense of power or self or you
right.
know
Which
or
makes her
choices.
Not
she's very happy with the prescribed role, but within that prescribed role, I think Stoker gives her a lot of exciting stuff to do, let's put it that way. I don't think Stoker, I who knows what his intentions are, but I think it's a quaint idea of what the new woman is.
You say that now, but a couple minutes ago, you flat out said that he was doing this a certain way, and now you're saying that you can't put words in his mouth, essentially.
Well, no, I'm saying that formally analyze the novel in terms of narrative structure, it's clear to me that of all the characters, Mina is the one that functions as author. Mina mm-hmm. is taking the role of the composer. She is, and in that sense, she is a stand-in for Stoker. I don't know what's in his brain, and I would suspect he did that inadvertently.
Right.
One would hope exactly. But anyway.
I mean, honestly,
I agree.
I feel like he just wrote a story, and it has nothing to do with feminism or any of that at all. He just wrote a story, and it wasn't that good of a story anyway. That's why it wasn't popular until people could start taking it and saying doing certain things with it.
You can't pull out this argument halfway through our discussion. Come on.
Oh no,
well,
I really am.
My issue is regardless if that's what he was doing, people still think that this is what a modern woman is or was at the time, and I'm saying no. Anyways, but to keep going, I'm almost done with my section and we need to hurry up. The other things I was just saying, there were two lines that really infuriated me in the book. Like, absolutely, I stopped and had to like go, because I was listening to the audiobook, I had to rewind a few seconds and listen to them again to make sure I heard them right. One of them was, this one I could find again to quote. The other one I couldn't find again to quote, but I remember. The one that I can quote is, "A brave man's hand can speak for itself. It does not need a woman's love to hear its music."
Yeah, I don't even understand what that means, honestly. I mean, I have an idea. It doesn't sound very nice, but
yeah,
what's the context for it? It's such a weird line.
It was, oh, Jesus.
Because so many other places, it's like a man, you know, thank God for Madame Mina, you know, she's here to support her husband, and what would he be without her? So it's like, really, you know what I mean? It's contradictory.
It's just man action versus woman's love. But I took it as... Yeah. Anyways, and then the other one, she has a line where she's saying that she's happy she has so many strong men to worry about her. That just really agitated me. I'm like, dude, shut the front door. But other
says
things,
that more than once,
something,
yeah.
the whole time I was listening to this movie, I just felt like women as a whole were being patronized. And that's the one thing that really bothered me. And it was, there's just certain things that like people say to women and they don't really realize that they're patronizing them, and stuff like, "You hit like a girl," or "I didn't expect
you throw like a girl."
Or, yeah, "You throw like a girl," or "I didn't expect a girl
that.
To be good at this, but you sure are." I mean, that's really patronizing. And then the biggest one, of course, is man brain. Infuriated me so much.
And what is the line? What does Van Helsing actually say? He says, "You have the heart or the emotions of a woman, yet the brain of a man. That's what makes you special."
No, he constantly refers to her mind as a man brain.
Yeah,
he says it more
times.
Than once. Yeah.
Yeah. But
if something can be said once, Helsing will find a way to say it.
Helsing is a very strange character as it is. He's not sexist, but he's the old man making a comment that you're like, that's racist.
Yeah.
But that was just how it was raised. He's constantly talking about how virile and strong the men are. It's like, okay, we get the idea. Why do you have to keep repeating that?
Well, and he keeps talking about how virile and strong the men are, and then how weak the women are and need help, and like they need the men to protect them.
Well, this. Oh, go ahead, Brady. You were going to say something.
I'm going to read this line. Particular segment is, whilst he was speaking, Jonathan had taken my hand. I feared oh so much that the appalling nature of our danger was overcoming him when I saw his hand stretch out, but it was life to me to feel his touch, so strong, so self-reliant, so resolute. A brave man's hand can speak for itself. It does not even need a woman's love to hear its music.
So she says that herself, but it's already very contradictory just in that line. He's reaching out for her, and she's saying, oh, he doesn't need a woman's hand. It's like, well, yeah, again in the novel, he's on the verge of a nervous breakdown, and she, like, helps him through it.
To me,
it's so contradictory.
Where they're talking about being vampires and these things exist, to me, it's like he is stepping up and he's going to be protecting her regardless of whether or not she loves him. To me, that's what I'm getting out of it. Not necessarily like he's not slapping her in the face by any means.
It's so odd because it's like she's constantly saying both things at the same time. And what's hilarious,
is that
he ends up in an insane asylum after he leaves Dracula's castle, and she has to go all the way to fucking Eastern Europe to pick him up. He's so pathetic.
He's in an insane asylum. He's just at a hospital.
I know, but he's lost his mind.
Yeah, he's had a nervous
breakdown.
He's got the brain fever.
He's
the man brain fever.
Yeah, he's not exactly the strongest person.
It's actually discussed because, like, when he does come to, it's because he realizes that everything that he experienced was reality. Like, he thought that everything that happened to him was just something that he fucking made up.
I know, but it makes him seem like a child for her to have to go collect him. You know what I mean? I never think of Jonathan as a strong. He's completely dependent on her, I think, in every way.
Jonathan does have a few parts in the book where he is strong. There's that scene where he goes into that one room and it's a nightmare, and even though he's absolutely terrified, he goes back the next night to try to figure it out.
Well, he's hot for the women, right?
Yeah. I don't think he's seen the women yet.
Well, yeah,
maybe. The thing is like he's kind of strong in the beginning, and then he's strong again in the end, but in the middle he's just a wash.
Right.
But in the middle
it's because like he for the most part he doesn't know what he saw.
Yeah, and yeah.
He becomes strong again once he realizes that Dracula is essentially taking his woman from him.
Yeah.
Okay. We need to hurry up because we still have your topic, Noel.
I do want to say one more thing about Nina, and that when the men come together, and of course this is led by Van Helsing, like 3/4 of the way, he says, I mean, she's been right there at all the meetings. She's been right there at all. They rely on her to get the information to everybody and keep everyone updated. And she even, and then they decide, oh, we have now because she's been bitten or because she's, that we need to protect her and keep her out of the loop.
No.
And she.
They say that because she's got a telepathic link with Dracula and they don't want Dracula to know their plans.
No, they say no, that's that exactly later.
Later well, they say that.
No. Because later it's not they said say that. Until after she says, hey, hypnotize me so I can tell you what's going on. And then later Helsing and Seward are talking. Because I remember thinking about this while I was rereading everything, because you guys had brought this up earlier.
Mm-hmm.
And specifically is, they decide to keep her out because they're afraid that if she knows
Dracula has a connection to her.
That's exactly why they do it. No other reason.
No, it doesn't work that way.
They even say that they don't want to do it because she is such a useful person for them.
That's later. I'm telling you, Brady, before... they decide that that it's just not appropriate for a woman to be involved when things start to get intense.
Yeah, that's the line where she says she's so happy that she has so many strong men to worry about her.
That is the time that they cut her out because of the...
No.
They do that, but later.
They cut her out because she's a woman and she can't handle these... Because that's where she has that line saying she's so happy she has so many strong men to worry about her.
So they cut her out first. Mm-hmm. She's pissed off, but you have to read that into what she writes. She's like, it was a bitter pill, but I swallowed it. And I can't find that quote. But Brady and I had said long ago when we first were talking about this that a lot of this depends on how you read it or how you
absolutely
interpret it. Like if I think in terms of a director, like I would have the actress make her rage clear. Even with the language that she's given, it depends on how it's acted, but that's the way I think. I'm thinking in those particular terms, that you can undercut some of the language. But basically, she goes to her bedroom, and while they continue the meeting, Dracula's in there. That's when he's forcing her to drink from him. Mm-hmm. So the one time that they tried to override her, the whole thing goes to hell in a handbasket. Now, it's after that they say, we want to make sure that Dracula's not getting anything telepathically, but they're really careful about asking her, and she says, no, in this case, I totally understand. But when they tried to cut her out before, she was pissed, but she agreed to it, the guys can't do it by themselves. They can't do it for five, evening, they can't do it by themselves.
Okay, I know what time you're talking about. They were actually going out to, like, try to kill him. Try to find him, and they didn't want to worry about trying to save her.
Right, that's right.
Rather
that's
than right. kill him.
Right. So, as if somehow she can't keep up, it backfires.
It wasn't for her not being able to keep up. It was for them making sure that they wouldn't sacrifice themselves for her.
Listen,
it's even specified. If I remember correctly, Helsing even talks about
it. They fuck up. It was the worst thing. It was the worst thing. The one time they try to get in her way, the whole thing goes to hell. Mm-hmm. They lose everything. Yeah. They almost lose her.
That's not what happens. But I'm just saying they had a reason for it. And it wasn't just because she was a woman.
But I think in a larger sense, I think a point is being made there. I can't help but think a point is being made there.
Also think about the fact that Quincy has been hunting and fighting for since he was like 3, apparently. Seward had been off and hunting with him multiple times as well.
Dr. Seward's got some sort of magic that they don't talk about, because Dr. Seward is just this crazy researcher, but when every single, like, Helsing and Quincy talk about him, it is with a reverence, like that man has saved their lives several times. Yeah, but they don't ever go into it, but it's like, Helsing, I want to know, is Dr. Seward, I think he's like secretly Indiana Jones or something.
That's right, they had that history, like we all went, that's right.
But Helsing does go in a little bit, like he essentially sucked out the gangrene from a wound. Quincy has respect for him because they've been out on multiple hunting parties and he's been doing so well with it. And then Arthur is just Arthur. But
Arthur has been hunting with his father, they do say that.
Right, but I mean specifically when it comes to Seward and Arthur, there's not a lot there, but I mean, they're friends.
But Jonathan has no experience, and they're still going to bring Jonathan.
He has experience with the vampire specifically.
There's no reason, but there's no reason why Mina can't know the plan and not go.
She can't be involved in the conversation.
They won't even let her be involved in the conversation, and that's the thing that backfires.
Actually went out on the hunt that she got attacked. It's when they were just talking about it. She could have been there for the plan.
They were about to go to it, and then that's
when... they were planning.
No, they were just having the conversation. Mm-hmm.
They didn't even want her to be part of the plan.
Eating the fucking flies. The entire thing is interrupted by Renfield, like, causing a ruckus and apparently being smashed against the wall floor multiple times. So it's not even...
No, I have to find it. I thought I had printed thing out.
When Mina gets bit, like, finally, like, gets on, like, full on, like, they run in and she's suckling on his face.
Mm-hmm. Sucking on his face? I think it's his chest.
That is the time that that when Dracula gets in.
Oh, here it is. All the men, even Jonathan, seemed relieved. And now for you, Madam Mina, and of course this has got to be Van Helsing. This night is the end until all be well. You are too precious to us to have such risk. When we part tonight, you no more... I didn't realize how bad his grammar was, or his English. You no more must question. Like, I could do other really racist accents with the same language. We shall tell you all in good time. We are men and are able to bear, but you must be our star and our hope, and we shall act all the more free that you are not in the danger such as we are.
Uh-huh.
And then Mina says, all the men, even Jonathan, seemed relieved. But it did not seem to me good that they should brave danger and perhaps lessen their safety. And perhaps lessen their safety, strength being the best safety, through care of me. But their minds were made up. And though it was a bitter pill for me to swallow, I could say nothing save to accept their chivalrous care of me. I mean, she tries to make it sound like... But it doesn't make sense. Like, why? They're not... They don't want her to know what the plan is, right?
No. It's not about the plan. It's about them going out to the danger. This part has nothing to do with the plan. It's about them going to kill someone, and they don't want her to be used against them, which is exactly what happens. But
now for you, Madam Mina, this night is the end until all be well. You are too precious to us to have us such risk. When we part tonight, you no more must question...
Because that's the night that they planned Don't to ask kill us. Him. They wanted that to be the end.
We shall tell you all in good time.
But that they don't even...
But why keep her from it?
Huh?
Because they don't want...
They don't want her to remain...
Saving they want, her.
With lady no, stuff. No,
but not even that. They want her to remain innocent, so they don't want her to know the gruesome details.
That's what it is, Brady.
Yeah.
I mean, because...
And it backfires badly. Oh, yeah. I just think
because it's not even, they're not even saying that they want to protect her from the fight. They're saying they want to protect her from the gore that's to come because they don't want her to question. They don't want to tell her. They said, one day we might tell you, but as for now, do not question us.
And then, you know, the whole deal with Lucy was pretty intense for all of them, really. Like, I think Arthur and Quincy both had to take
Sure, they mean
back.
Well. Of course they mean well. They mean I'm just well, saying yeah. that I think that happening that way it's an ironic moment. It's an ironic sequence because that very night.
Well, I mean, you also have to look at Renfield flat out said, let me out or you get the fuck out. Like when he was talking to Mina, he's like, you need to get away from here.
So right.
She
That's why
left the house and gone to another house. She would have been fine. If they would have let
Renfield
out.
Is that why Dracula kills Renfield? Because he tells Mina to go away?
No, he kills Renfield because he tricks Renfield into inviting him into the house and then kills him because Renfield is trying to stop him. Renfield is either jealous of Mina or is actually thinks she's wonderful and decides to try to stop Dracula, and Dracula says, fuck you, die.
Okay, so think about this. I don't know if anybody had this thought, but Renfield is never represented the way he is in the book. He's supposed to be older. He's supposed to be extremely physically strong. He's obviously a genius. He knows everybody before they even say who they are, and he knows everyone's backstory. Like, he's a genius. He likes to eat living things. Hello? Does anybody know? Who are we? Nobody thought of me?
I thought of you.
What?
I take that as a compliment. And then Mina says, because I think Mina's curiosity, she wants to learn and know and meet everybody. Oh. She says, I want to meet this Renfield. Take me to this Renfield. He sounds fascinating. I mean, this is not the words of a sheltered person or a fearful person. And it just seems, I thought he just seemed obviously, well, not obviously, but I caught a big whiff of Hannibal Lecter. He's not as malignant as Hannibal Lecter, but he's described almost exactly the same way. And you think I'm...
Oh, no, it's a really, really good comparison, to be honest.
Because he's never presented on screen the way he's described in the book, which is super strong and hard to control and, could be dangerous.
Right.
And I love that Mina wants to talk to everybody. I love the scenes with Swales, the old sea captain. Oh, the old sea, yeah. She's like, come tell me, what's up? You don't seem like you're doing too good. Tell me what's going on. It's like, and then I watched this BBC adaptation last night, and it's the closest to the book. It follows the book super close. It's like 2.5 hours from the 70s, super low budget. They turned it into a romantic thing, but they do follow the book quite a bit. But they turn Mina into a fucking simp. Again, the movie turns her into the film versions turn her into a much bigger simp than she is in the book. She's sitting with Lucy and Swales comes. And Mina's like, and he chats with them. And he goes off, he's gruff and whatever. And Lucy says, what a kooky old man. And but quite frightening. It's like, did you read the book? Have you fucking read the book? Why are you turning Mina into a simp? She's the one that initiates conversation with Swales. She's the one that eggs him on for him to. So it's like the movies are even worse. You know what I mean, Monica? Whatever you say about the novel, the movies are worse. Yeah, if you really were true to Mina from the novels, you would have on screen a much stronger character. I think if you had a real flesh and blood woman, I mean, it should be Jennifer Lawrence, but you know? Should be somebody.
We're going to just go out on a limb here and say that the best Renfield ever is Tom Waits.
No, because he's not strong. No, he's not matter.
Tom Waits. You just want Tom Waits to be in all your movies.
I really do.
Anyway, I'm not going to go into my shtick because we've already gone on too long. I think the Mina discussion is the most interesting one. Reading this.
I do have a closing for this one.
And you didn't want to say anything, Crystal, about the bromance?
There's only one thing to say is that I think it's fascinating when I see. And, you know, what you're talking about, too, which is people coming together for a common cause and how chivalrous everybody is and how complimentary everybody is to each other and how, like, just this undying love and affection for each other and nonstop stroking. And
so another question
it's pretty
I
amazing.
Have.
Wait. Let Crystal finish.
And I would say it's much like the current Fast and Furious films, which I really enjoy.
Super bromance.
They're just like, you don't even have to say anything because you're my family. And that's the end, and we're always friends. It's so positive. But and then also talking about Monica's point that people kind of might lie in their diaries about what they say to each other. All the men kind of still, you know.
Well, what I was going to say is, because this is...
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the end of Crystal's. All the men what?
They still stroke each other's egos constantly, even in their own individual diaries.
Do you think that's partly to deal with the jealousy of...
It might be, but they're
they
also...
They seem a little too okay with it, right? They seem a little too okay with not being
husbands. They are a little too okay with it, but I think maybe they just want to be close to her in some way.
That, and I think, is in the novel,
they all want
for sure.
As close as possible at the same time.
Maybe they want to, you know.
The mixing of their blood. But you know what? My sense is also that Quincy and Seward aren't that serious. It seems like their proposals were sort of half-assed. They didn't seem very, like, they didn't really know Lucy that well. They just
nobody knows anybody that
way. Seward was the one that actually did know her. I mean, Lucy talked about how she's known Seward for years, and he came to their house like every Sunday and had dinner with the mom. And Seward was the one that has been loving her for years. Quincy, I think, just saw a pretty thing and wanted it.
Yeah.
Quincy's also a hunter who has to have the best. And I think because the other two guys were after her, he's like, oh, the game is afoot.
Well, I also think he's like the American, so everything is like the best for my little lady. Oh, and of course, the Quincy in this BBC adaptation, the accent was so grotesque and so out of control. It was like, as an American, I'm actually offended right now. Anyway, sorry.
I was going to say about the whole everyone complimenting each other, I mean, they do say that basically all of what we are reading was transcribed through Mina, so I think it's interesting that maybe she just changed, like, oh, then Quincy said this about...
Harsher did type some of it up, too.
I like that idea a lot.
Jonathan did type some of it up, too. Like, remember, keep that in mind.
Okay.
I do have a closing for my...
Mina's basically making fan fiction of her
own. She's just like, and then Van Helsing said...
And then they were like, oh my god, I love your face. And then they made out.
You're like my best friend.
So that must be why you guys don't think that she is a good representation of the modern woman, is because she's
all right,
a 16-year-old
belly girl.
If she's
making fanfics, then yes, she is a great depiction of a modern woman.
Oh, you know what I just thought of? Jonathan fantasizes about three women at once.
No, he doesn't.
And then Lucy's got three men at once. Like they're...
three.
Boom!
It sounds like a Illuminati talk to me.
Sounds like what?
Illuminati talk.
No, I'm just saying Mina has a type.
Yeah, Godalming has no personality. I don't know why. Well, who? He just represents power, wealth, and status, right?
Yes.
He uses his status to get a lot of stuff done, but besides that,
Let's be honest. Like I was going to be a smartass and say that Lucy chose Arthur because he was rich. But during the first portion of the book, he's just like, no, that's not me. That's not me. I'm not into that. No. And then when his dad dies and he gets the title, he's like, fuck it. I've got money. Let's spend it.
Mm-hmm. And I love the fact that another thing that I like about Mina, she doesn't hold back. She's like, thank God for money, because without his money, we wouldn't be able to do all the stuff we're doing to get. Huh?
Seward says that, Mina says that, and I think Helsing alludes to it too.
Yeah. I think it's great that they're just, anyway.
I have a closing.
Go close.
I have a closing for my section. I just wanted to say again, for the book or the characters as a whole, I don't have a problem with Dracula. I do love it. I accept that it's a product of its author. And I agree that Mina Murray Harker is a fascinating character. She's a strange, contradictory combination of strong intellect and submissiveness. I just don't think it holds up today as many people do, and that's what bothers me. Another thing that completely flabbergasted me when I read this book, because I grew up with the Coppola film, is that Mina isn't the one that serves the final blow to Dracula.
Mm-hmm.
And in the movie she is, and I feel like that is her strongest point. Because especially in the movie, like, she's in love with Dracula, but she understands that, one, he's in pain, and two, it's not good. It's evil. And she's both liberating him and stopping the evil at the same time, and it's kind of her biggest selling factor in the movie as this powerful, strong woman. And when she didn't do it in the book,
you were disappointed.
I was just like, what? Like, I was waiting for it. The whole time I'm reading this book, I'm like, oh, yeah, she's going to get her 5 cents, like, at the end. And then I'm like, oh, no, she's just sitting back there with Van Helsing.
Well, that's a very 90s thing. The whole badass thing starts, and that's what that... But let me just say, and you already wrote it in my notes... I just think in that movie, I do like Winona Ryder sometimes, but she's played as the same simp. She has no backbone. I could be wrong, I could be exaggerating, but she's played as like a teenage girl, which Mina is never in this novel. So yeah, she gets.
I think that's bringing in the romantic, like, ooh, I like this guy.
But even when she's with Lucy, those stupid scenes in the garden. okay,
you should see when Crystal and I get together. You will think our IQs dropped like 50 points.
No way.
No, but we don't make out in the garden.
We don't make out. Shut up, Crystal. He doesn't even know that.
But Crystal,
it on the down low.
Did you have other things to say though about the bromance? Because I love what you said. And do you think that that's part of the fantasy of Fast and Furious and the novel, or do you think it's like, because no group is that perfect, right?
I know. I think that just
Entourage
makes
does
it,
that a lot. That's the big selling point of Entourage
about the adventure.
Yeah, it really does, and that's what makes Buffy so pleasurable.
No, we're not talking about Buffy.
we
talk about a strong female lead who is also girly.
Oh man,
and not very well educated, and relies on men to do most of the work except for the actual killing. Also,
oh, really?
The Scooby Gang, goddammit. They're the best people ever.
Wait, you're talking about the actual animated Scooby Gang?
Yes.
No, we're talking about Buffy's crew is called the Scooby Gang.
I don't like them.
Wait a minute.
We can't get into that right now.
I don't like
Buffy. Yeah, this is another topic.
Right, sorry. Sorry. But that's one of the things I love about the novel, I agree, is it's nice to read about a functional group. And I think that if you cast the right people, like Brady and I said, you can subvert the text with performances. You really can. And rather than do that, they make the women even stupid. They make Mina even stupider. They give her, they don't give her a place to start from. Anyway,
she's not the only problem. There's also Anthony Hopkins being a freaking weirdo the entire film. Oh
God, they make him so creepy.
But they make him, I love his matter-of-factness. It's like the opposite of Van Helsing in the novel, who never shuts up.
But he's still real creepy.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I love the idea, like, he kind of sort of adopts Arthur because he sees so much of his son in Arthur. And we get the little backstory of his wife is crazy and or sick and his son died.
I don't remember that. That's in the movie.
In the novel, maybe. Yeah.
Like, it's in the novel?
Yes.
Oh God, I don't remember.
He kind of just looks to Arthur as a
son. Yeah, it's kind of glazed over, but I do remember it being there. Yeah.
It's just so random, but then you never see it ever anywhere
mentioned
else.
Ever again.
And then Helsing becomes the vampire hunter, which... No, he was just open-minded to weird shit.
He was a doctor who explored the rare, bizarre diseases, which kind of made him a vampire hunter.
Right, but I mean, when we get into the exploring the lore that came after this book, like I brought it earlier.
He's been blown way out of proportion.
Yeah, Helsing is this great like vampire slayer.
Talking about Dracula and Mina being blown out of proportion, Van Helsing is just exploded.
Oh yeah, a lot. It's ridiculous. No,
he just has a cool last name.
Yeah,
but really I mean, he's the perfect mix of the rational and the mystical. Mm-hmm. You know, he's the one that bridges that gap.
Right. I like
the
concept of, you know, he's a man of science, but he's also like
science and a man of God.
You know that this could be vampires. Super cool, right?
He has a shadowy... He keeps going away and coming back. It's like, I need to talk to blah, 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 and I'll be back. It's like, what's the deal with Amsterdam? Like, is it getting high?
I think we know what the deal with Amsterdam is.
He's a very strange character, and I don't know why a lot of people latched onto him as well. I do like the idea of him being... he becomes immortal as well to always keep Dracula at bay, which is fairly entertaining.
Now this happens in what, many different forms?
Van Helsing in Dracula 2000, in Dracula 3000.
God.
Van Helsing, the movie Van Helsing?
Yes. The anime Van Helsing.
You mean Helsing?
It's not a man, it's an organization.
Well, no, Helsing, the Helsing organization was started by the original Van Helsing.
Yeah.
In fact, Alucard wears his costume, his hat and the coat. That mm-hmm. is actually what Van Helsing was wearing when he subdued Alucard.
Wait, what are we talking about now?
So
there's an anime, Helsing.
Oh, in the anime, Helsing.
My favorite incarnation of Dracula comes from Helsing, which was a manga originally got turned into. If you want to watch it, watch the OVA, Helsing Ultimate, because it's so close to the manga, and it's a lot of fun. But it never... We have Alucard, which is obviously Dracula spelled backwards.
And there's a Spanish movie, a Mexican movie, I think, called that.
There's a lot. I mean, even before...
I mean, Alucard is just Dracula backwards, so a lot of people use it.
Right.
It's but there's like a famous one from the 60s or something. Yeah,
lots of stuff.
But Helsing is basically, Helsing subdues Dracula and starts an organization where Dracula hunts vampires.
Yes.
Yes.
And
Alucard where Dracula hunts vampires? Yes.
Like he is.
Wait,
he
this is all too convoluted. We have books that we want to recommend.
Yes.
Are
you going to do your.
No, it's too late. I can do it another time. We can do a follow-up, or I can do a solo thing. But like I said, I'm just glad we got to talk about Mina, and I got to say the things about Mina that I wanted to say. That's more important.
I didn't get to bitch about Lucy being a slut.
We're going to do book recommendations.
Or movie? I don't know. What do you want, Monica?
I kind of wanted to keep this books, but I mean, this is a pretty big topic if you guys want to talk about movies.
I picked a book.
Going to suggest Helsing. Like the manga.
So it's the manga in print form? Okay. Is it
Japanese comic.
Is it one thing or is it a whole series?
It's 15 books?
15 small books that take 20 minutes to read.
Yeah. Yeah.
But they're good.
It's so good.
Mm-hmm.
So good.
Van Helsing's pretty, Helsing is pretty fascinating.
Yes.
Okay. Crystal?
I'm going to recommend, just real quick, the Vampire Hunter D novels.
Yeah.
Read those. Those are amazing.
They're amazing.
I couldn't find the film version. I don't know where to find it. Vampire Hunter D.
Make sure you don't get the 80s one.
Yeah. If you get the 80s one, the book is amazing. The anime is terrible.
No, it's not.
Oh, it's really bad. It's
very 80s.
It's just exploitative for no reason.
Yes. It really is, but it's
and like, that's what makes it so good for Brady.
I guess so, but the sequel, the follow-up that you should see, Noah, is called Bloodlust, and that one is
fantastic.
Beautiful artwork.
Also, oh, okay.
Amazing.
It actually follows more of the traditional. Me and Paul were talking about this earlier. Vampire Hunter D: Bloodlust. I mean, the opening is very akin to the original story, and then. What's his name? Meyer? Meyer is much like the Dracula in the modern depictions of Dracula. Mm-hmm.
Super romantic.
And it's a really fascinating anime. It's really good. But and the first opening scene could very well just be Dracula.
Yeah, it's like when he comes into her window, into Lucy's window, and, you know, feeds up upon her.
It's pretty fantastic.
But it's gorgeous. Bloodlust.
Bloodlust.
Yeah. And the end features Carmella as a character, which is really fun and just super spooky.
She's
dream logic.
Amazing.
Yeah, it is really quite lovely of a story. And they throw all kinds of stuff into it, but it's one of the coolest, like, you know,
sci-fi, fantasy,
pastiches,
horror.
Yeah, it's all that awesome stuff in one thing. So, yeah.
Great.
No?
So I shouldn't bother with Vampire Hunter D?
No, unless you read the novel.
Bloodlust.
No. Just watch the Bloodlust movie or read the novels.
Okay. I chose the Theology of Dracula. It's a nonfiction book. And it is so dense and so brilliant. This guy knows everything. And I haven't gotten that far into it because it's really, really rich. It's like, it's very thick, very dense, a lot. It's not hard to read so much as he puts a lot of information and ideas into a very small space. And his whole thing is he calls it the Book of Stoker as sacred text. He finds all this religious imagery that, again, like I said, when we talked about the witch, totally doesn't penetrate me. And there's like all these references and all this symbolism, and it's not just Christianity. There's like Catholicism, and there's like prehistorical kind of ancient. What am I thinking of? You know, nature cults and stuff like that,
like pagans, like
paganistic stuff, and like gospels that aren't officially in the Bible but are still like he finds stuff that, again, who knows if Stoker intended it, but this guy is so brilliant that he completely convinces you that Stoker intended this very elaborate. He looks at like the time the time cycles that everything happens in, and he does this whole geographic thing. It's amazing. And the solar cycle and Dracula. I mean, there aren't too many pictures in it, but here's one. And he, because this guy is so brilliant and he's so smart that you believe, you know, he convinces you. So I highly recommend it, but it really takes some time to sit and work on it. It's really new too. It's only a couple years old. And the guy who wrote its name is Noel. So, I mean, do I need I say more?
Coincidence?
I think not.
All right, Mons, what's yours?
Mine's a book that I literally just finished today, but I really, really enjoyed it. It's by George R.R. Martin. It's called Fever Dream. George R.R. Martin, the guy who does Game of Thrones.
Oh,
he wrote a vampire novel, and it's called Fever Dream, and it is pretty fantastic. It's vampires on the bayou during the, the time when steamboats were big, and it goes through the reign of Abraham Lincoln and slavery and vampires.
It's no longer big.
No, they're not. Well, they're size large, but popularity they are not. it's amazing. Like, I loved it so much because the two main vampires were very much like Southern gentlemen, and it's a good vampire and a bad vampire, basically. And there's a scene where proverbial shit is about to hit the fan. They're about to like go at the battle, and then finally the two heads are gonna face and they're gonna meet, and you're expecting like this huge epic battle, and they're just like, would you care to join me for dinner? And they sit down and just discuss things like Southern gentlemen, and I'm like, this is amazing.
I didn't know R.R. Martin worked in such contemporary times.
He's got a lot of other novels. Oh, there's okay. Another one I want to read, but I've got to read.
He doesn't write.
He
talks into a recording and somebody else types it. What do you mean he doesn't write?
He's joking because it takes forever for any of his books to come out. But that's because he does so much research and work on them. I mean, even Fever Dream, that's not part of his epic series, you can tell that he put so much work into knowing about this time and knowing about steamboats. Like, he knows everything about steamboats.
Do you think he overdoes it?
No.
I mean, does he need to research?
From the point of view of a captain of a steamboat.
Oh,
and
okay.
And so you have to know as much as this captain does. And the captain knows his boat inside out. And so so does George R.R. Martin, and so do you. And it's good. It's really good.
Vampires. I didn't know he did vampires.
He has a couple things. He has a few other books that he did before Game of Thrones that are he's done sci-fi too, which is the next one that I really want to read. But I've got a few other books. There's this book called The Historian that came highly recommended to me as a vampire book, but I didn't get to read it in time for this cast.
Who's the author on that?
The Historian. I have it on my Audible.
We can put it on the description.
Stova. It's kind of in the sense of Dracula, where it's this woman whose like aunt or great aunt has died, and she's collecting all of these journal pages, and then she's finding out that her aunt had a more interesting past than she realized, and it has something to do with vampires, but I haven't read it yet. But apparently it's very much in the vein of Dracula with the letters and the journal pages and stuff like that. So I was really interested to read that one too, but I just didn't get to it in time for this.
Okay.
Cool.
Okay, Monica. I have something specifically I'm going to suggest for you. Everyone else can read it too, whatever. But this is because A, vampires. B, you like the whole found footage, weird conglomeration stuff.
Ew, it feels more realistic to me for some reason.
There is a book called V-Wars.
That was another one I was looking at.
There's actually lots of them. There's multiple series when it comes to V-Wars, but specifically the one that started it all, edited by Jonathan Mayberry. That's the one you need to start with.
Mayberry.
Yes. It's got like four or five different authors. They all tell a different story, but it's not like you finish one story and then move on to the next. You'll have a little
bit. Now, Brady, the V-Wars I read was about something else.
What is that about?
Sounds like something scary.
Something anyway. Dirty. Anyway.
So you'll get a piece of the story, which is kind of like the full setup for the entire the world that they're creating, and then it jumps to another story, and then that one doesn't finish. It goes to the next one, and it tells this huge overarching story about what's going on around the world, and then it all just comes crashing together, and it's amazing.
Hmm. I had a lot of fun. The author? Like Snatch.
The authors. Mm-hmm. Happened to be like John Everson, Yvonne Navarro, James A. Moore, Nancy
The books
Holder.
Are all written by different
yes,
people.
But it's okay. Edited by Jonathan Mayberry, and that's specifically the one that I'm talking about.
V-Wars. Okay, that sounds good. V-Wars.
Okay. A lot of yeah, that's on my list for Audible. It's there.
We should wrap up.
Yes. So always thanks for listening to our first ever issue or video. Yes, we're not a comic episode of Book Club of the Dead. Tell us what you think about the original Vlad the Impaler, Great Bromances, or if you think I'm crazy about Mina.
Are you crazy about Mina?
I am crazy. I'm crazy about Mina. Yeah.
But we're not, Monica, we're not always good. It's not always going to be classic books, is it?
No, I don't think it's going to be classic. I think it should be well, I don't know. We'll discuss this. It'll definitely be, I think it should be big, like kind of maybe game changing books. Mm-hmm.
That makes sense.
But I mean, Stephen King is a lot of that, and he's not necessarily classic. But
well, I don't know. Some
anyways, Shining. The Shining is a classic. Salem's Lot's a classic. I don't know. I feel like they should just be bigger books, not just like we do a lot of random indie movies. I don't feel like the book should be that. Mm.
Unless it's really, really good. You guys have to tell me what to read, though, because I am so out of the loop on the fiction. But anyway.
Read everything.
Oh. Well, again, I don't have time to read, but I do audiobooks when I'm driving because I have a commute, so it's nice.
Best way to do it. Mm.
Totally. Okay, well, thanks for watching. Let us know what you think. Let us know if you don't like our name for this section. Yeah, we
Comment, subscribe. What's our email address again?
Tell us your fears at gmail.
Yes.
And thanks for joining us on this new adventure of ours.
Good night.
Bye.